This is the day that the Lord has made. Hallelujah. We rejoice and be glad in it. Thank God for another Sunday. Amen. Another week that he's brought us through. This pandemic, these dangerous streets, the stuff that could be in our body waiting to throw us a curve. We're thanking God for another opportunity to worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. So won't you come on with us? Start to make your heart merry and glad, and think about all that he's brought you through, all that he's brought you out of. It's time to worship the Lord our God. Hallelujah. So praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Because the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek thy good.
Those who be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
Blessed are they that dwelleth in thy house. Lord, I love thy habitation in the place where thy honor dwelleth.
For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All the earth will sing his praises.
Our hymn of the morning comes from number 243, Down at the Cross. Sing all four verses.
Thank you. morning, everyone. Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the invocation prayer, so to get your hearts prepared. Hallelujah, Lord. We do feel praise for you, Father. Glory to your name. It's a precious name. Oh, Father, we live with it every day, Father God, and you are there with us wherever we go, and we are so appreciative of that, Father. Father, we are here another day. You've given us another day, and we know how much favor you're giving us. You're favoring us so that we can make another appeal to others to come to you, Father God, to others who are lost, Father God, children who are lost, adults who are lost. We have another day to make an appeal for you, Father God. So speak through us, Lord. And we will step back and let you speak, Lord. We will step back and let you speak, Lord. Yes, Father. Father, we want you to speak. Speak out loud. Speak out right now.
Yeah.
Speak out through Reverend AJ here. Speak out through Pastor Rick. Speak out through Reverend Terrence. Speak out through the Brother Ron and Jordan who are here, Father God. Speak out through them. Use them. Use us as an instrument, as a vessel, to pass your word, to help this world come back together. Father God, we have so many things pulling us one way, pulling us another, Father God, but you are pulling us to you, Father God, and we need to stay on track with you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, for another day that you're blessing us. We slept comfortably last night. Father God, you are healing bodies. You are just doing miracles all over the place. You are keeping people from out of not being in an accident in a car. And yet they may have seen an accident just before them. And Father God, all the miracles we so sometimes we just take for granted. But we don't want to anymore. We want to see every miracle and observe every miracle and say, I have a testimony to the miracle that God has given us. I have a testimony. Over and over again, just reel back on your life. See how many times he has saved you, how many times he has protected you, how many times he has healed your body, whatever that might have been. If you had a headache, it's gone. If you had any pain, it's gone. Guess who did that? Not you, not Excedrin, but God. God is the ultimate Father. He's the ultimate doctor. He's the ultimate surgeon, Father God. Thank you. Thank you for showing up. Thank you for loving us so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you for another day of life on this earth so we can make a difference. Hallelujah, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
lesson this morning comes to us out of the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 14. Gospel according to Luke, chapter 14, beginning with verse 15 and reading through the end of the chapter. The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 14, beginning with verse 15, reading through the end of the chapter. Amen. Give you a moment to find it. Gospel according to Luke, chapter 14, verse 15 through 35. Amen. As usual, reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Amen. Hear the word of the Lord. One of the dinner guests, on hearing this, said to him, "Blessed is anyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God." Then Jesus said to him, "Someone gave a great dinner and invited many. At the time for the dinner, he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is ready now.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, 'I have bought a piece of land and I must go out and see it. Please accept my regrets.' Another said, 'I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I am going to try them out. Please accept my regrets.' Another said, I have just been married, and therefore I cannot come.' So the slave returned. He reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and said to his slave, 'Go out at once into the streets and the lanes of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.' And the slave said, 'Sir, what you ordered has been done, and there is still room.' Then the master said to the slave, 'Go out into the roads and lanes and compel people to come in so that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those who were invited will taste my dinner.' Now, large crowds were traveling with him, and he turned and said to them, 'Whoever comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even life itself cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king going out to wage war against another king will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000. If he cannot then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. Salt is good. But if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. They throw it away. Let anyone with ears to hear listen.'" Amen. And the Lord bless the reading, hearing, the understanding, and the performing of this his holy word. From all that dwell below the skies, let thy creator's praise arise.
God spake all these words, saying,
I am the Lord thy God, who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me.
Come on, sing it! Ah.
right now, but if you, hallelujah, if you're in a relationship with the Lord, it is a brighter day. Praise his holy name. That's the message of the gospel. We live in a world that's broken, that's fallen. We live in a world that's tore up from the flow up. Yeah. We live in a world full of people who are lost and don't know what to do. Violence is everywhere. And negativity on every hand. But there is a brighter day. Hallelujah. And old folks, you said a brighter day ahead, but it's a brighter day right now if you're in relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah. That's the gospel. That's the good news. It don't have to be the way it is in you. You don't have to react the way the world reacts. You can have a brand new brighter day every day when you get up. Amen. Hey, hallelujah. That was good. Thank you, Kirk. Amen. Amen. We come to our time now where we pray. Amen. Prayer time. And I've asked another man to come help us today. Pastor. Name is John P. Key. Amen. And while we pray, he's going to be in the background. Because we're all standing in the need of prayer. Amen. Family together now. It's time for us to pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, here we are again, Lord. Praising you and blessing your holy name for who you are. Thanking you, God, for loving us, for saving us, God, for keeping us from hurt, harm, danger, destruction, and infection. God, you've been so good to us. You spoiled us, God. And we don't know how to even try to thank you. But God, we ask you to accept our pitiful praise and thanks for all that you are to us and all, Lord, that you're working out in our lives. Thank you, God, for good times, but thank you for the bad times, too. Thank you for the rough days. That, Lord, you were able to tell us to just keep on persevering. There's a light at the end of that tunnel. And oh God, that light was you. We thank and we praise you, God, that you've seen us through times when we didn't know what to do, where to go, who to ask for help, God, but you came through in our situation. You healed our bodies, God. You gave us a brand new start. Father, we want to say thank you. Thank you for making a way out of no way. When there was no way, you, all by yourself, made a way for us. And God, we say thank you. Thank you for keeping us, oh God, through this pandemic and all of the stuff that's going on around us. Yeah. Thank you, Lord, for giving us hope, oh God, in the midst of this storm, God. Thank you, God, for allowing us to hear your word and your promise. Hallelujah. You never leave nor forsake us. So even though the boat might be shaking, it might be rocking, and waves might be coming in, hallelujah, we're with the master of the sea, and we know that we shall by no means, hallelujah, lose our life. God, we bless you and we praise you. We glorify and magnify you, Lord. You made sure we had something to eat this week. You made sure we had shelter, Lord. Hallelujah. You made sure it was a safe place, God. You saw us through, God. And when it looked like there was no way out, Lord, you made a way. We said thank you. Hallelujah.
Father God, there is no one like you, no one like you, no one like you, Father God. From the history of mankind, Father God, you have been with us. Even though we have stumbled and fallen and gone on a different wayside, Father God, you are still there. You are still there. We can still pray to you. We can still ask you for favors. We can still love you, Father God, because you're always, always, always eternally there. Father God, and sometimes I know we go on the wrong track. We go off a different way from what you want us to go, and then we fall flat on our face, Father God. Even then, when we say I'm sorry and ask for repentance, forgive us, Lord, you are there. You lift us up from all the dirt that we may have put ourselves into. We don't realize how much we are the mistresses of our own fate. We are the ones who make the decisions. We are the ones, from the time that we are able to make our own decision, Every decision that we made is our fault. If we made a bad one, it's our fault. And we want to blame somebody else, Lord, and we know that we're sorry when we do that, Lord, because it's no one but us. It's us. When we look at this pandemic and the things that we have done in this world, Father God, that have disappointed you, it's no one but us. It's us. It's us who's not forgiving people. It's us who's been judgmental. Yeah. It's us who's kicked people out of our lives. It's us. It's us. It's us who have done and made decisions that were not of your choice, Father God. And now we have come to you on bended knees, or even standing up, praising your name, Father God, asking for forgiveness of everything that we have done. Because you are still here, and over our ancestors, you were there with them. You were helping them, and if it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be here either. So if it wasn't for you, none of us would be here. Mm-hmm. So we want to praise your name.
Hallelujah.
And thank you, Father God, for giving us another chance. Another chance to make this day and make another day right, Father God. Until the time that we come to you, Lord, in the end when we die and we are in the casket, Father God, we will commit to you. We today, beginning right now, we want to do better than we have before. We want to be able to praise your name more frequently than we have before. Mm. We want to be able to read the word more than we ever have before. Because time is short.
Yes,
time is short. Time is short. Father God, but time is eternal with you. So we want to make sure that we walk that road every day, walking to you. Father God, we thank you and praise your holy name for just loving us so much, for giving us so many times, giving us another chance over and over and over again.
Yes, God.
Father, we thank you.
Thank you.
There's no one like you.
Yes.
There's no one like you. And we want to praise your name right here, right now, forever and evermore, Father God. Amen. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
blessing me. Over.
Continuously, can't you see he's blessing me right now? Amen. Well, mighty God, we serve. Hallelujah. You know, it's something how the Lord will give you a message where you can be where he gives you a message. I used to get a lot of good word at the So I used to go to the spa, health club, and while I was in the hot tub, the Lord gave me a message.
All right, sir.
Yesterday was while I was cutting grass out in the hot sun. And he gives me a message when I ask him a question.
All right.
The question was, why aren't more people committed to the body of Christ we call the church? Why aren't more people committed? Why can people just take it or leave it? Why can people just say, you know, it's not necessary for me, I don't really need it? Why can people just stay away from you? Why can't they come up with a conclusion, I don't have to serve, all I can do is spectate? Well, Lord, why is it like that? Why are some people really committed? Why are others not committed at all? And why are some so apathetic that they can take it or leave it? Well, why is that? Why is it that people who said they've given their life to you, who have at least come at one time or another to church, why is it that they can just quit following you at any time? And it doesn't take a pandemic to quit. It can be, you know, I just need to clean the house today. I just need to wash the car today. I just need to water the grass. I need to cut the grass today. I don't really have any specific excuse for not coming. I'm not feeling it today.
All right.
I was asking the Lord that, and he pointed me to the scripture. He said, not everybody is my disciple. He said, there are qualifications for my disciple, for discipleship. I said, oh, qualifications. And so he led me over here to the 14th chapter of the Gospel according to Luke, and he showed me these qualifications. But before that, he gave me the understanding through the parable of those who are invited to supper. And if we go back to it, meet me right there at 16. Hear the word of the Lord. Then he said to him, a certain man gave a great supper and invited many, and he sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, come, for all things are now ready. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. The first said to him, I have bought a piece of ground. I must go see it. I ask you to have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I am going to test them. I ask to have me excused. Still another said, I married a wife. You know I can't come if I married a wife. So the servant came, reported these things to the master. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets, the lanes of the city, and bring in here the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. And the servant said, master, it is done as you commanded. And still there is room. Then the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them. Come on in, that my house may be filled. For I say to you that none of these who were invited shall taste my supper. My, none. probably didn't take myself. Verse 25. Now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife, children, brothers and sisters, yes, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. My goodness, Jesus, that's a hard word there. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me, he cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he has laid it, the foundation, he's not able to finish. And all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Well, in the course of life, we see this parable, first of all, worked out. We see that the Lord has invited many to come into his house to partake of his supper, of his goodness. Matter of fact, the Old Testament prophet wrote, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Come experience his goodness. Come and see if he's not good. He says he's good. Come and see if he's not good. Come and allow your life to become a part of his life and see if he's not good. Test him out.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, in Malachi, he said, test me now. See if I won't open up the windows of heaven. Pour you out a blessing you cannot. God wants to be tested, but a lot of people won't come.
All right.
Because they got misgivings. They got all kinds of different feelings. Where I end up but a place where hypocrites hang out. But they forget what the real purpose is to get the life of Christ in them.
Yeah.
And so they make excuses and they stay at home. Well, you know, I got stuff to do. Well, you know, they're giving all the money to the pastor. Well, you know, stuff is not right. And so they don't come. They don't come. They opt out. They make excuses and they stay away. And how does that work? Well, if we would take a moment out and look at the folk who are not connected in any way, shape, or form in a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, we would say, well, those folk don't look like they're blessed to me. No, I see them with problems. I see them with heartache. I see them with trouble. I see them suffering. I don't see any comfort in their lives. I see them having all kinds of problems, and guess what? So do we who are in the body of Christ. But we've got a comforter.
Yes, yeah.
Who will help us through these conditions. So that at night we're not considering taking all these pills at one time. At night we're not running a knife back and forth across our vein, figuring out, can we bleed out in the bathtub? At night, we're not figuring out, should I go out here on the road and just jump in front of a car? Should I jump off the bridge? Shall I put this noose around my neck and hang myself from the shower?
All right.
We're not doing that because we've got hope.
Yeah.
But those who have made excuses, don't want to come into the body, look at their lives and see what kind of peace they've got in the midst of the storm. They've made excuses. And here's what Jesus says. Those people will never taste of my supper because they have rejected me. That's the first part. The second part is those who have come in. Those who have come in and become a part of the body. Those who are intending to realize the promises of Jesus. His promises have to do with those who serve him, those who are his disciples. And many people don't consider themselves to be a disciple, but let me tell you what a disciple is and what he considers a disciple to be. A disciple is someone who will learn, because he said, take my yoke and learn of me. It is a learner of his way, a learner of his word, a learner of his will. That's what a disciple is. A disciple is a person who wants to learn about the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, first of all, My first qualification is, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, brothers, sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. My goodness, what a qualification.
Yes, sir.
Lord, you said hate. Do you really mean hate? What he's saying there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is destruction. I've got a way, and if you choose my way over the way of your husband or wife, your children, your brothers and sisters, and even your own life, you will see life. You'll be my disciple, and then when you're my disciple, all the promises that I have made belong to you. Hallelujah. All the promises I've made belong to you. Well, wait a minute. That's only the first condition. He said, whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Well, what's this bearing of the cross thing? What's that all about? Well, we know the cross is a symbol. It's a symbol of suffering and of shame. It's not something I just tattoo on my back or on my arm. It's not just something I hang around my neck and walk around or put some on my hat or my jacket. No, it's more than that. My cross is an emblem, but it's my suffering and my shame. Because what it meant to Jesus was crucifixion. And as we see Jesus hanging up there on the cross, he wasn't having a real good day that day.
All right.
They had whipped him all night, beat him. Some folk had even spit in his face, his own folk, and slapped him upside the head.
Yes.
He had had a bad night. And this is what suffering and shame looks like? Yeah, that's what it means. It means I've got to crucify my flesh. I've got to suffer for his name's sake. Well, I know a lot of us don't want to suffer. We don't want to suffer, period.
Uh-huh.
But in suffering for his name's sake, there's a promise. Oh, what promise is that? What kind of promise is there in suffering? What does suffering have to do with anything positive coming out of it? Well, if you still got your Bible open, meet me over in 2 Timothy, the second chapter. 2 Timothy, the second chapter. Beginning with, I believe it's verse 12. Beginning with verse 11. This is a faithful saying. If we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful because he cannot deny himself. Verse 12 is what I want you to look at. If we endure, and some translation says if we are persecuted, if we endure persecution, amen, we will reign with him. If we suffer, that's what it says. If we suffer with him, we will also reign with him. Well, what do you mean suffer? I thought this, when the preacher gives us the invitation, he always says life's going to be better. Things are going to be better if we come into the kingdom. Things are going to be better if we choose Jesus. And what are you talking about, preacher, about the suffering? Well, wait a minute. If the master suffers and we're his servants, are we greater than our master? No, we're not. Well, here's the good news about suffering. The good news is that if we suffer for his name's sake, there's a promise that goes with it. It's just not needless suffering. It's not just needless pain. It's not just needless time that we waste suffering. We're suffering for his name's sake. That means I'm trying to do right. That means I'm on the right path. That means I'm doing what he told me to do. I'm trying to love my enemies. I'm trying to do good to those who persecute me. I'm trying to do those things that he wants me to do that I might realize my discipleship to him. He's teaching me how to live. He's teaching me how to be different. He's showing me his way. His way, which leads to eternal life. The good news in suffering is I'm not suffering by myself. The suffering that I go through is just like the suffering that he went through. So if I take up my cross and follow him, if I go the way of suffering, if I go to crucify my flesh, if I tell my flesh, no, you can't have this. No, you can't go there. No, don't think about that any longer. No, don't react that way. No, vengeance is not yours. If I tell my flesh, no, it can't have what it desires, I'm crucifying my flesh.
Yes, yes.
There was a theologian, his name was Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He lived during the time of the Second World War. He ultimately was killed. He had a moniker that he called Cheap Grace. Cheap Grace. Cheap Grace was, or is, what we consider God given us favor, and we never give him anything in return. Cheap grace. So he gives us favor. He allows us to ride not on the low of life, but on the high of life. He makes a way out of no way. He gives us stuff that we don't deserve. He comes through in the midst of a time when there's nobody else to help us. That's grace. That's favor. We understand that. But what makes it cheap is we never give him anything in return.
All right,
we never give him any praise in return. We never give him any worship in return. We never give him any part of our life in return. He gives to us, but we don't give to him. That's cheap grace. So he never gets anything praiseworthy out of our lives. Other people see us and we look just like them. Other people see us and they say, oh, if he's in the church, he looks just like the world. He acts just like the world. He talks just like the world. He reacts just like the world. He's full of vengeance and anger and all kinds of animosity. He's got a bad attitude. And that is not indicative of what we call Christianity. And so I accept the goodness of God. But in return, all he gets is shame from me. That's cheap grace. As his disciple, how can I stay qualified? Well, because I consider him more valuable than my family. He said wife. He said mother and father. He said sisters and brothers. He said also children. Because I consider him more valuable than them, I can be his disciple. Well, wait a minute. Not only that, he says I gotta take up my cross, that which causes me to suffer, and follow him. Follow him through these trenches of life. Follow him through the hard places of life. Follow him through the places where it don't always feel good. And for most people, that could be the church. Wait a minute. If that's the church, how does that work, Pastor? The church, shouldn't the church be this? Shouldn't the church be that? People have this misconception of what the church could be or should be. The church can be, and most of the time is, a place of suffering for your flesh. I said something then. Right. Yeah, because you didn't get the solo in the corner. It's a place of suffering. Because you didn't get the accolation. It's a place of suffering. Because somebody turned their head and it looked like they didn't say hello to you. It's a place of suffering. Because nobody included you in this thing or that thing or the other thing. It's a place of suffering. It's a place of suffering because you don't get your way. This is about God's way.
Yes, sir.
And God's way causes us to feel not that good. Because we've got to conform our way to his way. Oh, are you listening to me this morning? So sometimes the place of our crucifixion is in fact inside the four walls or inside the, hallelujah, the ecclesia, the called out ones, that which we call the church.
Uh-huh.
And why should it not be that way? Wasn't it really the church or the religious folk who crucified Jesus? Wasn't it the religious folk who rejected his kingship? Wasn't it the religious folk who didn't want to accept any of his teachings? Wasn't it the religious folk who saw to it that he would get a bad trial? Wasn't it the religious folk who said, give us Barabbas? It was the religious folk.
Yeah.
So Jesus suffers because of religion and religious people. So how are we any better if it caused him to be crucified? Won't it also cause us to be crucified? Then isn't that saying brought to pass in 2 Timothy 2 and 12? If we suffer like him, we will reign with him. Oh, you know, the world is all about good times.
Yeah.
Amen. The world right now is having a bad time because all the good times that the world likes to have been shut down. Or they were shut down. Now, I guess now they're almost rolling. Sports is almost back. So all of the diversions that cause us to get our mind off of that which would cause us to have or understand eternal life are coming back now. And once they come back, we'll take our mind off of kingdom things and put them back on worldly things.
All right, sir.
There is nothing but death in the world, my brothers and sisters. When we align ourselves, when we make the world our God, when we come to the place where only the world can make us happy, only the world can give us what we need, we're rejecting his way and his will. If you're going to be my disciple, he says, you're going to have to give up some things. You're going to have to take up your cross, the way of suffering, and follow me. Follow me in the suffering. Follow me through the midst of ridicule and persecution. Follow me when it doesn't feel right, when it doesn't feel good. Follow me when it hurts and it hurts bad. Follow me when nobody likes you. Follow me when nobody approves of you. Follow me when things look like they're going to fall on you all the time. Follow me when you're always the scapegoat. Follow me. Because when you follow me, you follow me into life eternal and abundant living here in this life. Wow. Is it like that, Pastor? Is that the way it is? That's what Jesus says. And I believe him. We've got a lot of entrapments in this world. We've got a lot of things. We've heard a lot of people preach prosperity. Come on, get in and you'll prosper. But the truth is, come on, you get in and you'll suffer.
Yeah.
But it may not be the kind of suffering you think it's going to be.
Uh-huh.
You might be blessed with all kinds of riches. You might be blessed with all kinds of wealth and things of that, but the real wealth is not in that. The real wealth is being able to sleep at night. The real wealth is being able to think without your mind being bombarded. The real wealth is not having blame or shame follow you around. The real wealth, hallelujah, is knowing that God accepts you for who you are and he loves you. Hallelujah. Because you're bringing him glory. Brothers and sisters, it's time for us to be real disciples. If you're going to be a real disciple, you're going to give up some stuff. Yeah. Matter of fact, he says you're going to give up your life.
Yes, sir.
And what we say is life is really our lifestyle. Yeah. Well, you know, I would like all the flash. I like all the bling. I like all of that. I like somebody to see me out riding and then I'm leaning. I like somebody to say, oh yeah, I like that car. I like that house. I like that ride. I like that job. I like those clothes. I like that which he's got. I like all of that. And if I'm living for that, then I can't be living for God. I can't be his disciple. It's time for us to take up our cross and follow him. Taking up the cross will not feel good. It's time for us to accept the fact that if we suffer with him, we will, according to his promise, reign with him. And that's not for a day or an hour. That's forever, eternally. My brothers and sisters, we put our focus on temporal things too long. Time to take our focus off of the stuff that can decay, fade away. Somebody else can steal. Time for us to take our our focus off of that and put it on that which is eternal. God has a way, and that way always, always is the best way. Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Might be somebody out there today who's never tried him. You've been messing around for a while. You've been saying you're going to come in, but so far you haven't done it. The Wayman brothers have got a word for us. And as you sit there, won't you contemplate their words? Amen.
Jesus said, here I stand. Won't you please let me in? And you said, I will tomorrow. Jesus said, I am he who supplies all your needs. And you said, I know.
Sunday, and on the third Sunday we always have the Lord's Supper. And so won't you fix your hearts now and make ready gospel says, or it says in the word in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, that people were taking the Lord's Supper in a wrong way. And it says that the way we're supposed to take it is remembering his death and dying. So when we say this is his blood, which was shed for you, for remission of your sins, have a picture image in your mind of his blood trickling down out of his hands, his feet, out of the thorns that were stuck in his head. Amen. Out of all of those lashes that were placed in his body. And then have an image of his flesh shredded for you. He says, this is my body. Take and eat. We eat that which he sacrificed that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So I want you to fix your heart now. Get your cups ready. We'll take it all at the same time. AJ is coming now. She's going to lead us, amen, into our Lord's Supper.
This is such a special time to prepare your hearts. This is the affirmation of faith. Let us profess before God and one another our common faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord always be with you.
And also with you.
Let us humbly, humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God.
Almighty God, Father our Lord Jesus Christ, creator and judge of all people, we acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and offenses, which we have committed against your divine majesty by thought, word, and deed. We do earnestly repent, and our heart is sorry for these our misdoings. Have mercy on us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us of our sins and offenses, and grant that we may hereafter serve and please you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. In the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Also with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to set forth your glory in all the world. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, 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 Lord God, power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All glory and power and honor to you, Almighty God, Holy Father, creator of heaven and earth, who did make us in your own image, and when we fell into sin, you of your tender mercy did give your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his own oblation of himself once offered a full and perfect sacrifice for the whole world, and instituted and commanded us to continue this perpetual memorial of his precious death until his coming again. For in the same night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink all of it, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, with this bread and this cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us, and believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Gracious God, you are holy indeed, the fountain of all holiness. Bless and sanctify these gifts with your Holy Spirit, and bless us to your service, that we may faithfully receive in unity and peace the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the bidding. O merciful Lord, we do not come to your holy table trusting in our own grace and mercy, but in the greatness of your mercy. We are not worthy enough to gather up crumbs under your table, but you are the same, Lord, and your love has met and always will meet every human need. Grant us humble access to your love in the sacramental feast of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, and wash away our sinful pride, that in mercy we may be drawn near to you and to him who with the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen. You that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins are in love and charity with your neighbors. You intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking henceforth in his holy way. Draw near with faith and receive the holy sacrament, making your humble confession to Almighty God. Won't you now get your cup? Get ready to share it together. Take off your first covering. Amen. Precious body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is broken for us. We feed on him by faith with thanksgiving in the heart, and we're thankful. Would you now open up your cup? Precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the blood that he shed, hallelujah, for the remission of our sins. We take this together and drink it. We say thank you. Have now renewed our covenant which we made at our baptism. We pray that prayer, first of all, thanksgiving. God of grace, we give you praise and thanks for this holy communion of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, the pleasure of our redemption, and we pray that it brings us forgiveness of our sins, strength in our weakness, and everlasting salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. We pray that God will bless you this week as he's blessed you in previous weeks, as his protection will be as strong as it's always been. Hallelujah. Keep you from hurt, harm, destruction, and infection. We pray that his word will make a difference for you this week. And we pray that if you have the opportunity, or rather make the opportunity to get into a Bible study sometime this week, and to a prayer service. We have Bible study every Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock on the prayer line. Amen. You can call in. You don't have to read, but if you want to, you can. We have a very informative time learning about the Word of God. We are getting a lot of revelation in this time. Amen. Thank God. We look forward to being with you again next Sunday. Amen. As we hear God speak out of eternity. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God. According to the power that dwells in us, His Holy Spirit, unto our God, that be all majesty, dominion, power, and praise now, hallelujah, and even forever. And all who agree, saying, Amen.